Just have a look. It's one that's just coming back to one of those seasonal effects. There might be something in that, because what we don't know about is the actual levels. Although the water level will be the same, the pollution might be actually changing a bit.
Okay, if we're talking about seasonal effects, perhaps we ought to return to our assumption that pollution has ceased. If we take into account pollution, then there will be a seasonal effect that we ought to consider as well. I think Bob Thoman has something that he can say about that.
The agricultural input of nutrients to the lakes does not come in a steady way over the year. And it comes in much more in the spring, with the spring runoff from spring rains and the spring fertilizing, than it does in the winter. That can have a significant effect on the net impact of the nutrients on the lake. In which case, a simple model that assumes the concentration or the mass of chemical coming in from agriculture is a constant throughout the year may not be appropriate if you want to then control that chemical. So then we begin to ask consecutively more detailed questions as one looks at the more at more and more details on the controls. It is usually the issue of controllability that starts to determine the degree of complexity in the model. And the example of the spring loading of nutrients is a good one in that respect. So little by little, as the questions become more and more detailed, then we begin to incorporate more and more features into the model.
That really encapsulates what we're doing in the modelling process. Start with a simple model, go round and round the modelling loop, bringing in extra features as we develop and work towards our final model.
Okay. Well, we've been talking about the modelling process, but in some ways more to think about what the reason for all this is, and this is to predict the pollution in the Great Lakes. So let's leave this discussion by seeing what the people who actually did the modelling thought about their own modelling process.
The PCB models that were done on Saginaw Bay in the late 70s, early 80s, now that we have measurements in time, those models have proven out to be, and the predictions that were made concerning the reduction of PCBs were right on the money. So I feel good about the work that we've done, that this team of engineers and scientists over the last 30, 35 years in this country and around the world, the contribution that we've made to predicting and then helping decision makers make those really tough decisions about banning chemicals and reducing discharges. We live in an exciting age as far as mathematics computing goes. I mean, we've got powerful, powerful computers that allow us to calculate and do anything. We have these software packages that allow us to see, to visualize our calculations now that we couldn't before in living color, technicolor in motion. It really requires a team effort, a team of scientists and engineers, including mathematical modelers, biologists, chemists, toxicologists, to focus in on a few important problems and to focus their resources and their effort in a cooperative way in order to gather the information, the data, is required to do this and put the models and generate the computer programs and do the post-processing, the visualizations of this. I hope the newer generation of scientists and engineers, social scientists and politicians will have the foresight to do this, because after all it's our earth and we need to understand what's going to happen in the future, because we're a technological society. We're having tremendous impact on the environment, and the only way to reach real rational economic solutions to this is to understand and to predict what will happen in the future to the best of our ability. And I hope that's what we'll do.
Thank you.